I've got to say, the opening sequence isn't that good. Isn't that good? Don't answer that, Roy. Hello, everyone.
Tremendous. A lot of effort went into that. A lot of skilled technicians put in a lot of effort.
All right. I've changed my mind.
Yeah, good.
Welcome to Day 12. Welcome to Democracy Day here on The Dream in Athens. And now, I'd like to introduce to you formally a man who bobbed up on Dick Pound's novel, has bobbed up as number 4 on Dick Pound's top 100 Olympians of the modern era. I refer to rampaging Roy Slaven. Well, it's incredible. He's top 100, Roy.
Yes.
Look, I know it surprises me that Lars Klepich is at number 1.
Yes.
The sailboarder, the Australian sailboarder.
I do have news on Lars. He's been out there for about 2 weeks.
Yes, the whole 2 weeks.
On the Mistral, on the board. Came in at about 8th, I think, which is a fantastic achievement. And for all those kiddies at Russell Lee Primary, well done, your man. Got in 8th.
Now, the second is the Milo de Croton.
Yes,
I don't know how he managed...
Was he in the modern Olympics?
No, well, I was just going
to
say...
He used to lift oxes.
That's right, in the ancient Olympics. I don't know how he managed to squeeze...
Well, that's typical Pound, isn't it?
Pure
Pound. He doesn't think it through.
No, he doesn't
think it through.
No idea. Then, of course, the number 3.
Yeah.
The number 3, well, this was an exciting news. It was Kevin Gosper. And then...
Wow.
Now, how do you feel about that, Roy?
In very august company...
Well, I was surprised. I would have had you at 3.
Yes, and Gosper at 4.
Yeah. That's exactly how I was thinking.
There's no argument about Klepich at 1.
No, that's true. No argument about Klepich at 1. Now, obviously the fallout from the boat in Broglio continues here, and it has now been revealed, and I hope I got the stats right here, that of 33 sports here in Athens from Australia, only 5 are using psychologists. And I raise this because the rowing... team, the rowing tilt here, Australian Rowing, hasn't seen fit to employ a psychologist to help their crews perform better at the Olympics. The ones who are sailing, and gee, we've just burnt the Mediterranean. I mean, apart from Klepich, they've disappeared over the horizon, haven't been seen. Basketball, well, the blokes went out pretty early. Girls there holding the torch aloft. Hockey, the reverse. Girls went out pretty early. Blokes still in there. Swimming, you'd have to say, tick the box. Yes, it's working.
For women.
Women. The probe's still on for the blokes.
I won't resile.
No, you won't resile. And triathlon, well, obviously one. Not so bad. The men still to come. So, Roy, were you shocked as I was that only, of only 5 sports are using psychologists here of the 33 that were
represented? I couldn't believe that statistic. I couldn't believe it in this day and age.
It's incredible.
In this day and age. And it puts a lot of... It makes it too hard for those helping out over at the village. And I refer, of course, to John Eales.
John Eales.
John Eales has had to do everything. And he's not an Olympian. We've said this before. Never been in an Olympic village before.
No.
He's got no idea. All he's done is played rugby. Tricky though it might be. He has to deal with idiots and sooks and all that sort of stuff. We know that.
We do.
We know that. But it's putting too... It's making it too difficult for the bloke.
Well,
and psychologists, I mean...
They're trained.
They're trained.
He's not ticketed.
He's not
trained in anything.
No.
He's trained in rugby. Sure, it's great. Honesty, commitment, all that sort of stuff. I'm an Australian. I'm on a wallaby.
Passion.
Yes, passion. Make of that what you will. All that sort of gear. But let's have a look at him in action. He seems all at sea. I don't want to bag the bloke, but here he is struggling.
Yes.
You know, obviously with the
reels. Yes,
yeah, that's
know,
good. Here he is. Have a look at him in action.
Yes.
Bringing the girls out for a photo shoot.
Tired
a horror
tiring.
Shoot.
Yeah.
He's been up all night swinging the watch in front of him saying, what happened? Tell me all about it. Get it off your chest. You'll feel a lot better if you tell me the truth. All that sort of stuff. That's Eales. He's just picked up a book on the airport. Freud. How does it work? That sort of stuff. And all of a sudden, he's got this burden on his shoulders. Remember, 5 sports, the rest don't have it. The other 28, all they've got is Eales looking after him. I mean, it is an outrage.
What a burden.
What a burden.
What a burden. I blame Coates.
Do you, Roy?
Coates. I mean, I thought I'd get that in a Coates.
Can I ask?
Coates. Oh. I mean, he's got so much money at his disposal.
Yes.
I mean, there are so many psychologists. About every second kiddie I speak is doing a psychology degree.
Yes.
It's relatively hard to come by.
No.
All we have to do is employ, what, 33 of them?
33, one for each sport.
They come cheap as buggery. And all they've got to do is sort out the difference between that, weed out those who only think they want a medal.
Right.
But in their heart of hearts... They don't really want a medal. And that's what you get to the bottom of. You know,
yes.
A lot of kiddies say, yeah, I want a medal. you only think you do.
Is that what a psychologist
does? That's what a psychologist does.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
That's my understanding.
And how do they do it, Roy? Have you got any insights? Is it really on the, you know, they lie back like this and somebody swings a watch over them? Do you really want a medal? That sort of question. Oh, yeah, really? Do you really want a medal? They hoe in hard.
No, I think you're with I think when you get them alone, when you get them alone, you ask them the first time, do you really want a medal? They're going to say, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But do you really?
No, really.
That's when they
jigs up.
That's when they crumble and say, no, you're right, I don't really want to. I don't belong here. No. I've just been training all my life for bloody fuck all. Right. And then you weed them out.
What did you train your life for, Roy, again? Just give me that to again. Yeah, bugger off.
But anyway, it goes back to Coates. Why doesn't he just open up the purse strings?
Well,
he's got billions.
Well, apparently...
Billions!
Apparently it was budget cuts that caused the fact that only five teams were able to bring the trick cyclists with them. Now, we've got another... well, if that solves that problem, well, we've got to go back and look at it. I mean...
I don't think it's worth a probe yet.
Don't you?
No, not yet. No, let's just see how it falls out in the wash.
Okay, now, one of the things that happened last night was the 100 metres hurdle. In the 100 metres hurdle, the Canadian runner got off to a bad start and actually careened into the first hurdle, and that caused her to fall in front of the Russian runner. We've got this on footage here. We might be able to go to the replay here. Have a look at this. Early on, obviously that... Oh, way! And it's hard to do that in a hurdle race, take out your opponent and yourself at the same time. I mean, there it is there. Just whoa, the great pictures. And we did see earlier in the heats of the hurdles a new form of the race. Oh, you can never tire of looking this, can you, Roy? That's fantastic there.
Beautiful pictures.
And, of course, disconsolate Canadian and rueful Russian at the end of the night. Now, obviously, we did see a new form of the hurdles being pioneered here in Athens, of the limbo hurdles, where you go under every bar apart from over. Unfortunately, the IOC don't know whether to take it up as a sport or just say, oh, well, you know, it's still at the demonstration stage. Having said that, though, Roy, there are now calls to restage the 100 metres hurdle. Are you supporting these calls or are you saying, well, it happened on the night, too bad.
Too bad.
Here's your medals.
Well, unfortunately, that's the way the IOC have said it, HG, the official protest lodged by the Russians, which had my support.
Uh-huh.
It had my support. Uh-huh. I phoned the Russian Federation, Athletics Federation, and said, look, if you want my support...
They
said, yes. I said, fine, well, you've got my support, knowing that it wouldn't make much of a difference. But full credit to the Canadian kitty. She knew she wasn't going to, you know, because she'd tumbled. Full credit for taking out someone else. I'm not going to get it, nor are you.
Now, when the receptionist of the Russian, chef de mission...
Vladimir,
said yes, and then you went on yes, and then you asked him a trick question. How old are you? And he still said yes.
That's it.
Did that worry you at all?
Not at all.
Good.
No, not at all.
Oh, that's fantastic.
No, you have my support if you want.
Yeah, that's right. Now, this raises a question concerning a number of things that are bobbing up here. Reruns is one of them, which we're obviously sort of a bit proppy about, but if nations want them, we're prepared to support them on a case-by-case. It's not a, you know, sort of cover-all thing. We're not just supporting reruns for the sake of reruns.
Go back to the start of the games.
I'd love to see the start of the games.
On the basis of...
Yeah, well, the quiet medalists weren't given up. Or didn't win. Weren't first across the line. Look, there's now a call for Ringrud Cockatoo, that great horse that helped Bettina Hoy sort of win and lose gold at the same time, to be given a medal as well. Roy, would you support this, for instance?
I think I would. I think the horses have been much maligned and ignored. You know, when you go through the records of who won in equestrian over the years, and I've done this, I've been through my David Walakinski last night after I spoke with the Russians. I thought, oh, equestrian, I might just have a look. No mention of the horse.
No.
No mention of the horse. Just, you know, Andrew Hoy riding no one. Right. You know, riding nothing.
You mean
how much Kaiba TikTok? How much these great horses feel? You know, they just have ignominy. They just turn into glue or buried.
I'm gutted. I'm completely gutted. You would think that it should be Andrew Hoy up on Kaiba TikTok one day.
Or Kaiba TikTok. Open brackets, Andrew Hoy.
Wow, what a better way.
Goal.
Yes. Look, I am in two minds about this,
I know you are.
Because, you know, look, We explained the problem. We went in hard on Bettina Hoy, saying she was an idiot, a goose. Then we realised we'd been a bit cruel. Mm. And so the next day we saw it was the system.
Yes.
Now, if the system's buggered, i.e. you don't know when to start, you don't know when to stop, all that sort of stuff, you can't see the clock counting down, there's no red, green, I've got to go now, that sort of stuff.
No.
You know, well, then it's a bit hard to think that the horse deserves a gold which was stripped from the winner who had it under false pretences, if you follow him adrift.
Yes.
You know, in other words, Ringwood Cockatoo
was equally to blame.
Well, equally to blame, and in the end did bugger all to win the medal because it obviously started before it was meant to. Mm. So I'm in two minds about that one. Mm. The other one that's bobbed up is whether cyclists who make up the team in the event should be awarded gold medals as well. This has bobbed up in, think, the cycling recently. The cyclists are left in tears when they missed out on the pursuit team.
Yes.
I think four ride, six in the team.
Yes.
What do you think about this one, Roy?
Well, I think so. It happens in relays with swimming, doesn't it? If you swim in a heat and the team wins, you actually get a medal as well. I'm all for that, I think. Mm-hmm. I'd support that. I've said publicly I would support that.
Did you say that to the Russians?
I said that to the Russians last night. As an aside, oh, by the by, before you go, I'd like to add my weight. Would you support me on... And they said yes.
Your goal. Now, look, there is an odd thing that's happened as well with the medals is that now the USOC, the United States Olympic Committee, tried to do a deal with the Korean Olympic Committee to strike another medal for the South Korean in the Paul Hamm matter on the gymnastics. I mean, this is getting labyrinthine, isn't it?
Yeah, I know.
Is that what you'd support?
Well, I just think that's rubbish.
Yeah,
I think that's rubbish.
Yeah. Cause?
Yeah. Well, you can't have replica gold.
No, true.
What does that mean? No. I want a replica gold. Is it a real gold? No, it's a replica.
It was given to me because...
It was given to me because I was doubted by the judges.
Yeah.
In the eyes of the US Olympic... I mean, it's just rubbish.
I know.
It just rubbish. They should have been just told to bugger off.
Yeah. Mercifully, that call has fallen on deaf ears.
I know, deaf ears. Even the Russians hadn't heard of it when I mentioned
Now, the next one.
Yeah.
You wonder where some people get off, where it'll stop. Now there's a call for a medal to be given to fourth place getters. It's zinc. They're describing it zinc. Now, in Australia, at the moment, I think we've, in the Australian tilt here in Athens, we've got beach volleyball fourth. We've got canoe and kayak are fourth. We've got four fourths in the cycling. We've got one in the diving. We've got three in the rowing. Sailing, we've got a fourth. Shooting, we've got a fourth. Swimming, we've got two. And we have potential in volleyball and water polo for the men and the women. Beach volleyball, that is, in the water polo. So we're looking at about 13 fourths. Roy, do you support a call for a man for fourth place getter?
I think if you come fourth, you deserve something. Maybe just a four in cut it in tin. You know, with Olympic rings on it, and maybe a clown hanging off it. Which enables you to go to the head of queues on public transport in your native land.
Lovely idea.
You know what I mean? And maybe once a week might get you a free loaf of bread.
Yes.
Something like that. Just to, you know, so people are there. As long as you wear it all the time.
Yeah, you'd have
to. You can't just pull it out of your pocket.
Yes.
You've got to wear it all the time. There's the bloke who came fourth.
Now, what about fifth?
No. No way.
Now, in the official medal...
No way, you just lost.
Yeah, true. You're a long way from the front.
There's an ill for anyone who participated after fourth.
Yes. Now, would you include this in medal tally? So you might find that Australia has, you know, quite a lot of medals, and I can't do them off the top of my head, but there would be, at the moment, 13 zincs, or whatever they're called. 13 fourths. So it'd go gold, silver, bronze...
And we've had a lot of tin.
Yeah, tin.
Yeah, let's say 109 tin.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, that's how it would work. But would it add to your medal tally, is what you're saying?
I am.
I don't think it should. No. I think it's just something that the fourth place getter gets to thank them for making up the numbers and making first, second and third look really good.
Well, thanks for that. Roy, and the Russians, where are they on that?
They have no opinion.
Right. There'll be more after the break from the Russian members. And that impressive-looking site was Speaker's Corner in the Star of Attalos here in Athens, one of the historic sites here. And Roy, as I understand it, it was from that very spot that St. Paul began converting Athenians to Christianity.
That's absolutely right.
It's incredibly humble.
I know. We went there and we were just amazed, weren't we?
We were moved.
Yeah, we both got up there and had a yell, didn't we?
We did. We basically...
To Athenians?
Yes.
Anyone who would listen?
Well, there weren't many who were listening at that particular time. In fact, they just moved on and thought we were loonies, which is fair enough because we were pretty silly. Speaking of loonies, the sport of synchronised swimming does attract its fair share, but can we... Why don't we do it in harmony here, Roy, and do it... Let's see if we can do synchronised plate smashing. Not bad. I gave myself 4. And again. Unbreakable plate. Synchronised swimming. Look, can I just say that something bizarre is going on in synchronised swimming? And I refer to the fact now that so much of the routine appears to be done, what I'd call, in the dry, on land, before the so-called swimmers, get it? Swimmers, you know, take the plunge. Let's have a look at Italy's tilt here. Spaziani and Zaffalon, they chose as their theme the Lars Klepitsch story. And we have a look here. I mean, what is going on here? I was looking at people wanting to get wet. I mean, this is a virus, Roy, that seems to be infecting the world of synchronized swimming. Get wet, girls! Get in the water! At last. Now, you think it's a one-off. You think it's a one-off. The USA, Bartosik and Kazolova, they decided to enter the Olympics here in Athens with a nice piece of work that I was looking forward to, the Wall Street crash of 1929. However, when they come out, there's a touch of the Spaziolian and Zaffalon all about them. I mean, same music, which I like, obviously. I'm not going to get confused there. Here they are. What has this got to do with synchronised swimming? I mean, it's...
This looks sick to me. It's just sick, isn't it? It's for your raincoat brigade.
It is. I mean, now, I should have warned kiddies not to look at this segment. At the end of the water, they go at last. Mercifully, to cool off. They were that bloody hot. Finally, the Netherlands, who had chosen as their theme, sister combination, the building of the dikes. Here we have Bianca and Sonja van der Velden. And look at this. I mean, this is just lewd smut. We think we're at an Olympic event trying to encourage kiddies to get fit. Well, this is one way of getting fit, but I've never seen it taught in a physical education class in any school in Australia. Finally, at last, they take the plunge. Now, having said that, the Australian team,
yes,
who, let's face it, were bagged by the judges.
They were the Canadians in particular.
Yeah, and bagged by the commentators.
Here they are, actually.
Here they are. Look. Laird and Nichols, they did something called the relaunch of the Monaro, and they just stand there, a couple of flips, straight into the water. That's how you do it.
That's how you do it.
Get wet straight away. I mean, I am outraged. Where is this going to end, Roy?
Look, it drives me berserk, this. It is what I'd call, and kids go, leave the room. Leave the room. It is bullshit choreography. It is bullshit. Let's face it. When choreography, when a form, any art form goes rococo, it becomes meaningless.
Yes. Does it lose
this
you, Roy?
This is meaningless.
Yes, it's lost you.
It has absolutely lost me. I was there with you. I was offended. I walked out.
Yes.
I looked for something to smash.
Yes, well, you got something up the end there.
Yeah, I know. We don't have enough plates. I need a billion bloody plates to smash.
Yes.
To make my feelings clear here. It's got to be weeded out.
Yes.
What's Coates doing?
Well...
Nothing.
What's Eels doing?
What's Eels doing?
Nothing.
What's Gosper doing?
I saw Gosper...
Oh, sorry. Don't often do that.
No.
Poke you in the eye. I saw Gosper there.
Did you? Licking his lips? This is my sort of go, was his quote. You know what I mean? First on the bus, where are you going? Sitting and swimming up there! Oh,
well,
no.
Well, he didn't seem as offended as I was. Let me put it that way.
And the Russian embassy, Roy, when you rang them this morning about it?
Well, they love it. But they are... they are sickos, really, aren't they? Anyone who enjoys that has just got to be sick.
Roy, What can be done about it? I mean, I don't
want to... We've got to ban it. We've got to say synchronised swimming, OK? Swimming involves water. Pool. Yeah. Get it? And it's not as if their choreography was synchronised in any way.
No,
one gets down, spreads the legs, the other goes over.
Look, and
if they both got down, spread the legs, and, you know, then you might think, oh, well, they're synchronised.
Look, can I just say that one of the nice things here is there hasn't been what I'd call much of that loody underwater camera stuff. So if the girls want to get it on under the water while they're doing the synchronised swimming
Fair enough.
Come up with a sick grin and the nose like this, well, I love it. That's great. But why do we have to see what's going on under the water, on the land, before they take the plunge, Roy? That's what gets me really riled. Anyway, there'll be more riled right after this on The Dream in Athens.
Olympic record is 34 seconds. Then Mears comes up to the line. The world record! The world record is gone! 33.952! Anna Mears is a champion!
And now can you welcome our gold medalist in the 500 metre individual time trial, Anna Mears! Yes, well done and congratulations and thanks for coming in. What sort of bike do you ride?
I ride a BT on the velodrome.
And are all the bikes the same?
Our team bikes are all the same, yes, but when we're back outside the national team, we do sometimes ride individual bikes.
Now, when you come along, you see maybe some of these top European riders riding a better bike than you, and you think, well, what a blow. They've got that gearing that I'd like and all that sort of stuff. Does that happen sometimes?
I generally look at the paint job more so than the bike. There's a Polish rider with the tiger pattern painted on his bike, and I love tigers, and I walk in, I go, oh, I want your bike.
And they all, obviously, they're all individually custom built.
Mm-hmm.
And do you send off, what sort of measurements do you have to send off to get them made? You know, meaning is it inner leg and, you know, sort of, height and all those sort of things?
Yeah, leg height, arm length, all that sort of stuff counts. So you don't want to be riding too short a bike in the arms.
Sure. And what repairs can you do to the bike? I mean, I can still actually mend a puncture. Can you mend a puncture on your bike?
I can mend a puncture, but it takes me some time. So it's great when you have a group of boys in the bunch because they generally go, oh, chick's got a puncture again. So they go, I'll change it. And it's much quicker.
How many technical support people are there for the team?
We have a pretty minimal amount, actually. We've got two mechanics, two coaches, a manager, one head coach, two masseuses, and that's it for the entire team.
And how many bikes do you have here for that specific event, the 500 metre?
I ride the same bike for every event. I just change the handlebars.
Right.
Roy? Yes. Is there any need for a psychologist, do you think, for the team? Would that be useful or would it just get in the way?
It could certainly be useful, but... you know, I think that the psychologist is a bit scared of some of our sprint boys.
Well observed.
Yes,
very well observed.
Would be. And probably they're the ones who are in more need than psychological help than anyone. Now, is this a quick velodrome? I mean, we've had a lot of emails, people saying, could you get out and measure it? I went out and measured it the other day. The measurement is fine, incidentally, you can relax there.
Thank you very much.
But it seems incredibly quick. I had a ride on it and I couldn't believe how quick it was.
How'd you go on the banking?
Yeah, the banking I liked. Now, what do you put down the quickness of this velodrome to, if you indeed agree with me that it is a quick one?
Yeah, definitely a quick velodrome. And, you know, because it's made of wood, if it's hot and the air is dry, there's not so much moisture in it, then the wood gets harder.
Yes.
And that actually makes for less resistance on the rolling of the tyre as you roll around the track, so it makes for quicker riding.
Quicker riding. And what about your tyres? What sort of tyre pressure are you using these days? You know, anything over, say, 33, 34 PSI?
Or... 220
PSI. 220
PSI.
Bloody hell.
So if you get a puncher, it sounds like a gun's going off.
Yes, yeah, indeed. And does that vary much according to the type of velodrome you're on?
It varies according to the type of tyre.
Right.
And our tyres are specially glued to the wheel.
Yes.
So it takes a lot to get that tyre off if you do puncher it.
Right. Okay. And now I love the. Aerodynamic helmets. Everybody
yes.
does.
Yes.
Everybody does. Is there any talk of aerodynamic gloves for the hands? any talk at all?
Well, you'd think they could do something like that, but, you know, you'd think maybe the feet or the legs,
yes.
But they have standards where you can't actually cover your legs, so...
Are you allowed to cover your hands?
Yes.
Well, why hasn't somebody done that? Why hasn't somebody come up with that?
We have gloves.
Oh.
We do.
With aerodynamic wings that...
No, haven't invented that, but if anyone's got thoughts, bring them in.
Now, the helmet, is there any rule about...
Yes.
What you can do?
Yeah,
it can only be a metre long.
No, this year they brought in a rule. It has to have a standardised helmet inside, so it has to be foam inside. So they were getting to the point where they were 1 millimetre thick and very, very thin on the helmet, on the head, and they were worried if someone had a crash and, no, they'd have no luck in surviving, so they brought in a new rule.
Now, you're here, I don't mean to be unkind, but because your sister's crook. And can you actually beat your sister at this event?
I have beaten my sister, yes, on a number of times. But I think once she gets better and comes back into the competitive ranks, it'll be very interesting to see how we both go up against each other. And it'd be great if we could get to the world stage again and go 1-2.
And how's she? You've obviously spoken to her. How has she responded to your success?
She's had a great time. I've always had a text message on my phone once I've. Before and after all my racing, she's always the first one or second one there to go, oh, great ride, you know, I don't care if you come last, but great ride, you look great, you know, brush your hair too, you need to, you know, make sure you put your lipstick on when you go to the cameras.
Oh, perfect, that's the detail you need.
Very, very good advice, very good advice. Do you have any superstitions?
I do. Before any big international race, I personally paint my own fingernails with the Australian flags. And I always wear black socks for time trialling. I have a special pair of black socks that only get worn for time trialling.
Are they washed between events?
They are. They are.
I'd say you need a psychiatrist.
Look, Anna, thanks very much for coming in today. Everyone who comes on the show gets this special Olympic pin, which is in the shape of a spade, a 24-carat gold spade, indicating a shovel, should I say. We'll have a discussion about this in a minute. Indicating our desire to finish the games off and obviously dig around and find lots of things here that have yet to be uncovered. We'd like you to accept that as a souvenir of your time with us today.
Thank you very much.
As well, you don't go away empty-handed either. You get the golden shovel toilet paper.
Can you please thank gold medalist Anna Mears? Yes, Pink's Hill. Shots of Pink's Hill there where 508 years ago, or should I say, let me do the maths here, you know, 508 BC, they dug up democracy there. What did it look like, Roy, when they got it out of the ground?
It looked terrific, actually. That's where men freeborn in Athens...
Would natter away.
Would natter away. They'd turn up each week between 6,000 and 10,000 blokes and go through the issues. Decide on the plumbing, what the street names were going to be, that sort of thing. That was the birthplace of democracy. That's how it came about.
Incredible. Sort of like... I don't know what you'd say, like a local council.
Yes.
In those days.
Absolutely. Exactly the same.
It's incredible. And one of the sports they did in their breaks, you know, they'd talk for about 3 hours and then they'd break up into generally in weight divisions and they'd have a grapple. And that sport became Greco-Roman wrestling, and we're only more than happy to satisfy all those demands for a little bit more of this red-hot sport here in Athens. Let's go over to the Greco-Roman right now.
Yes, we're back with the 55 kilogram for men Greco-Roman pulled seven elimination. We've got Koryikian from Greece in the red up against Sheng in the blue, and we've got it underway now. And obviously Koryikian is a linguist. He can speak a number of languages, Roy, and he employs all the dirty words he can muster to get him through his bouts. At the moment, as you can see, all locked up together early in period one. Your thoughts on this bout, Roy?
Well, dirty words... doesn't surprise me that he'd stoop to this use of, and Cantonese dirty words, HG, like chinois. He'd be saying that a lot.
He wouldn't stoop that low, would he?
I wouldn't put it past him. Look at this, he's got him where he wants him.
And beautiful pictures there, magnificent. Yeah. They're shocked, the handlers, his people, as obviously we can see. Oh, magnificent work there! And China obviously looking a bit under the gun there with the black eye, 5'4" of Sheng, now copping a terrific hammering at the back in the dog. from Kioiki, and the linguist shouting in his ear, shouting in his date those dirty words. It's a real grapple off here. Greece get a point and go up early in period one, Roy.
Yep, so it's beautiful about this. Look at the domination of the Greek there. He's no stranger to this position. He knows what to do with the play when he's got him like this. Although the judge has stepped in now to
centre the bout.
Yeah, to bring it back to Tors, so to speak.
They're going for the finger grapple now.
I'm surprised he has made more of the eye. That eye is a real weak spot for the Chinese kitty.
Well, he might have a go. He's got another couple of points there. He's having a go now.
He's getting
into that
eye.
That eye. He's got his shoulders down. The crowd are going berserk, as they should. And I tell you what, when you've got a finger in your eye, you don't think about your shoulders.
Ah, it's a fantastic bout.
Isn't that brilliant?
Enormous strength here from Sheng. Being underneath, he's lifting himself up. Look at that arching of the back. He's rolled over on the side and he's saved himself a point. But the Greek guy going into that eye
Greek's
is scoring.
Gone up seven blot. I mean, he's really just ramming it. It's as if he's got it bent over the front of the bonnet. And he's just ramming away. Ram. Right into that eye. Gouge.
Crowd up on their shoes. They're loving this. This is Greece's best. Kioikian, the linguist.
Yep.
5'2".
The pride of Greece.
He was born in Russia. He debuted for Greece in 2000, and he's got the Sheng tilt powering before he's on.
Look, he might be unconscious. He might have choked off his windpipe completely. Obviously, he's removed the eye, and now he's just working away at that, choking off the air. If you can deny oxygen to the brain, the body will follow.
And it's getting the dirty words out there as we saw.
Yep, he is.
And look at this. He just moves the hand and release there.
No, just showing he could.
Disappointing. I think he might have tipped himself into touch there. And that was terrific. As we go, he ran out of time, Roy. Sorry, he ran out of time there. And so the period one certainly belongs to Greece at the moment. Now back for period two. And the Chinese Sheng, a bit wary here as we go in. There's the sort of finger hold. He's trying to get lower than... he's trying to get into submission there, hoping to lure the Greek tilt Kioikian into a bit of an overcommitment there. But Roy, it's tremendous quality stuff from the 55.
Oh, he's got him again. He's got him again. Look at that.
He's spread him.
He's probing. Yep.
He's probing for an opening. Immersively, the Chinese leg resumes the closure there, seeking closure there with the legs.
He's trying to wriggle his way out, worm his way out of it. But I think the Greek is too wily for that. Look at that. He's just toying with him now. He's kneeing his back door.
He's up to eight. They obviously set it. And there's the local priest in for a look. And why not? Obviously, the Greek Orthodox Church. Great supporters, Roy, of Greco-Roman wrestling.
Always have been.
And often put on a bout in church to lure in the crowd when it congregations are diminishing and seeking other pleasures. There's no better way to get the flock back than putting on a good bout of Greco-Roman wrestling. Roy, obviously the Chinese...
In lieu of a sermon, HG, in lieu of a sermon, I'll call a couple out at the congregation and let the boys go at it.
They will.
That's the story.
It's a great story to be told there, especially when one church, say, Pelini, take on the Plaka.
Yeah.
Because they're both great nursery, Troy, of Greco-Roman wrestling.
Yeah, you forget that. Pelini is one of the great nurseries, always has been.
And remember, we are living in the second golden age of Pericles here in Greece.
Arguably. Arguably, yeah.
And so it is easy to get excited.
Look at this classic shot, AC. Look at this classic pose that they strike every now and again that evokes the pots.
Here's the crowd getting right behind... Kioikian's tilt here in the 55 kilogram pool.
Yeah.
And golly, wouldn't a gold here just bring this crowd to its feet later on in the week? It's just tremendous work.
Yep, a little butt of the eye there. The Chinese boy's really suffering. He's had his head worked over, his throat worked over, his eye worked over. Obviously, his back door belted in a few times by the knee.
And Roy, I think they should invoke a mercy rule here. First to 10, I reckon, and then it's all over. It's just not encouraging kids to get involved. If they think, you know, Greece is always going to be the nation to beat, why would they bother? Same as the Chinese in table tennis. You know, it's just a lopsided bout. But elimination pool bouts, and the crowd there rightly declared the winner. No surprises there. The linguist can speak Russian, German, Armenian and Greek, obviously. Goes through to the next round. Top quality gear, Roy.
Beautiful. Beautiful bout.
And Roy, you have seen some of these bouts in a church.
How does it work with the audience?
I think it goes over very well. I went to, down to the church in Pollini, as you know, last Saturday to see a couple of bouts, and it was just great. Mm. Great atmosphere.
Mm. Great between atmosphere. The hymn and the sermon,
yep.
They put on a couple of bouts.
That's it.
Fascinating. There'll be more from the Dream in Athens right after this.
Go in.
She possibly can, I think, right now. And Kate Allen's about to go straight past her.
She knows she's there as well. She knew she was coming. She knew she was coming here. Desperation on the face of Loretta Halep. Halep, but you've got to take your hat off to this woman. Allen has been superb in the run. Bridged an almost impossible gap to come home.
Well, what an extraordinary last lap we've seen here. Kate Allen has snatched the gold medal from Loretta Harris. What a performance in a last dash. Oh, so late, and from Loretta Harris' point of view, oh, so cruel.
And now, can you please welcome the silver medalist in the women's triathlete, Loretta Harris. Thanks very much for coming in, and you've just come straight from the course. You've still got your numbers on.
I was hoping it had changed by the time I watched it on TV.
Now, what was happening to your people there? Surely somebody should have been shouting out, look out, she's coming, she's coming, get a wriggle on. Were they trying to communicate that to you, that Kate was there?
Yeah, I think by the time they realised as well, you know, she was coming pretty quick. I actually think that she might have been flowing up to me. I'm not sure. people were screaming at me, and the last turnaround, about 500, 600 metres to go, I was flat strapped, so I couldn't really do much more.
What communication are you allowed? You know how the bike riders have people in cars and you can see earpieces. Yeah. Are you allowed any communication in the triathlon?
No, I mean, there were people screaming, obviously, on the sidelines. All different things, so
yes.
it's a bit hard to make it out, but you know, we just I did hear the commentator say that she was picking off fifth place, then fourth place, and I was thinking, oh gosh, I can't really go much faster. But yeah, no, it's okay.
Now, I've got to say, Kate Allen, the winner, is an Australian, lives, born in Geelong, now running or competing for Austria. How many Australians are actually competing for other countries at the moment in triathlon?
Yeah, it's unfortunate for Australia, but yeah, it's happened a lot. I think Kate, though, hasn't really been back to Australia for 8 years or something. She doesn't race back here, so she's definitely Austrian now.
Right.
Yeah, I was going to say, Loretta, it was an extraordinary race. The triathlon is often, you know, incredibly exciting, but that was one of the best, and that was just a wonderful performance.
I'm glad I could make it exciting.
Yeah, it certainly was. Look, how much? It was pretty. It's pretty warm today. It's pretty hot out there. How much does that take out of you? How much weight loss do you undergo with an event like that?
We had been prepared. The old hydrating few weeks before, the days before, but it's still hard to prepare yourself, you know, for dehydration. But I was aware of that, and I tried to make more of an effort to drink a lot more than I usually do on the bike, and even on the run, I took in more fluid than normal. But I didn't feel too bad. It was definitely hot, and just that bike course was really tough. It took a lot out of you.
Roy,
how much water have you had since you completed the course?
We went straight to doping control, and I drank about 12 bottles.
12 bottles of water. Yeah. And without putting too fine a point on it, the wee didn't come easily. Is that right?
No, but that could have been stage fright. I mean, we do have someone standing right there.
Yeah, yeah. All right, okay.
I was just going to say, Roy did the course this morning, and... there was a hand-timed result communicated from down there of 2 hours 9:67. Hand-timed, not officially timed. He described the course as an old-fashioned bastard, HG. You know, they've really gone out of their way.
It's
gone out of their way. How, you know, in terms of the degree of difficulty on the course, how would you rate it?
Yeah, I was just using harsher words than bastard.
But it was tough. Honestly, that's the toughest course I've ever done. Even the conditions, it was windy around that headland that we had to bike. So once we went up, we had an 18% gradient on the bike, and it was 5 laps. But once you went down the hill and took the sharp left, it was still uphill and into the headwind. So you're just like, oh, the downhill just disappeared. I don't know where it went. I thought if you went up, you had to come down, but it didn't feel that way.
Now, in the race, tactics, very hard now, of course, because it's over and, you know, it's very hard to assess so quickly. Obviously, you would have liked, you know, to be 100 metres further along the track, but was your ambition to go out there and really largely throw down the gauntlet to the opposition and let them catch you, or is it possible to run the race in another way?
No, I think, I mean, for me, that's the way I race, and it was probably a little unfortunate for me today that the other American girls weren't really on their ball game, and I could have probably worked a little bit with them, and we might have got a bigger lead, but that's the way triathlon goes, and that's the way sport goes, and I gave it 100%, and I really did. And, you know, I went that last lap of the bike, or the last two or something, by myself, and that's hard, but that's actually the way I got in the Olympic team for Australia. I went from start to finish by myself, so I knew I could do it if I really had to.
What are your plans? I think that's... Will you have the energy to party tonight or not?
Oh, I'm getting there. Like I said, I think I might have a shower and a massage. We have to be a little bit quiet because our men race tomorrow.
Oh, yes.
That's very unfair that
it is.
We...
So will you leave the village for dinner tonight? Will you go outside?
We're not actually in the village yet. Being triathletes, we need to train outside.
Yes.
And we're staying a little further out. So we move in the village day after.
Oh, okay. Okay.
And does, difficult question on the day, but does another 4 years and another Olympic, you know, go? Triathletes seem to have quite a long career in the sport.
Yeah, I went to Sydney and, I mean, this has been way better for me, and I've enjoyed it a lot more, and I think just the nerves were a lot more settled this time around. And I must say I've had a really good year and reaped some really good rewards, so I'm not going to rule it out.
Well, that's very good to hear. And look, everybody who comes on the show gets this exclusive Olympic pin. 24-carat gold in the shape of either a shovel or a spade. Take your pick. As a souvenir of your time here, we'd
thank
like you to thank
much.
That. And Roy?
Yes, you get the golden shovel toilet paper as well. Very special. Only a few of these made. One for you.
Special.
And can you please thank silver medalist in the is a sport that does make its participants often look as though they've never done it before.
I know.
It has that rare...
It can be cruel.
It can.
And the pole is a cruel mistress.
Well, quite right now. People have got in touch with us by going to thedream.7.com.au and following the prompts. Who you want to start with tonight?
I have one from Dale. Thanks, Dale in Adelaide. Mm-hmm. He says, further to previous emails regarding equestrian horses and bikes being part of the opening ceremony... The sailors could walk in with their yachts, with the bottoms out of their boats, Henley on Todd style. I also think the shooters should be able to take their guns with them. As well as increased security, they would come in handy in case one of the horses fell over. And the sailors in the boats could come over and provide the screens that cover the view to protect the kiddies. He's thought it through.
He certainly thought it through.
What a lovely addition.
It is fantastic. And I've got one here from Thomas in Perth. He says simply, and this is the best email we've had for a long time, because of its brevity, your show is cool. Nothing more needs to be
Isn't
said.
Isn't that lovely?
It is good.
Isn't that lovely? And I should point out, HG, that we are getting, you know, the odd email, and we don't get a chance to read them all.
on air.
Thank you very much for all the emails, and they are read. All are read, but we don't have the opportunity, obviously, to do them all. Now, a medal tally, actually, and this is very much for the interest of those at home. It's a medal tally state by state where medalists were born to show which states are putting in and which ones aren't. And we've included all team members, I should point out, and Kate Allen, who won gold today. She's from Geelong, I think.
Yes.
So she's included as well.
I should point out she won it for Austria.
Yeah, for Austria.
Yeah, work it out. You go.
Loony.
Okay. It's globalisation, of course.
New South Wales, 10 gold, 14 silver, 9 bronze, total of 33. Well done. Yeah. Queensland. Queensland 10, 8 and 5, total of 23. Victoria 3, 3 and 3 for a total of 9.
Wow.
Not so good, is it? Western Australia 2, 4 and 2 for a total of 8. Northern Territory, we're calling a state tonight, 2, 1 and 1, total of 4. South Australia 1, 1 and 3, total of 5. Tasmania 0, 1 and 0, total of 1. Right. ACT, blot. And overseas 1, 2 and 3. Three for a total of 3. Yes, so that's of interest.
Fascinating.
New South Wales, well done. Queensland, very good.
Yes, Victoria, what's happened there?
Lift your game.
The tilt's come awry. The view ahead, we've got cycling. Ryan Bailey and Shane Kelly in the Kieran.
Oh yes.
Oh, baffling event. Just impossible to understand. Graham Brown and Stuart O'Grady in the Madison.
Yes.
Baffling event. Yana, of course, goes over the hurdles at 4:55 a.m. In the morning. That's Eastern time, and that will be one worth setting the clocks for, a very yes. dramatic event.
We'll stay up all night.
Stay up all night, an all-nighter, all the way, as we will be conducting here on the Dream in Athens. See you tomorrow night. More from the Games of the 28th Olympics. Bye now.